charity subs. So, as this piece of footage hopefully shows, we have the misfortune of being three-dimensional objects that are sadly stuck to a two-dimensional surface. Edwin A. Abbott, a Victorian school teacher, wrote this book, Flatland, which he called A Romance of Many Dimensions. And it's sort of a satire of the English class system, but it's also a fantasy world that only exists in two dimensions. The satire of the English class system is that the beings that inhabit this flat land are triangles, squares, pentagons, and the absolute lowest class are the triangles, the soldiers and manual workers. And then come the squares, which are slightly more sort of the managers at the lower end, and then the pentagons, etc. But all of these beings only slide across this flat surface. Edwin Abbott describes, imagine a vast sheet of paper on which straight lines, triangles, squares, pentagons, hexagons, and other figures, instead of remaining fixed in their places, move freely about, on or in the surface, but without the power of rising above or sinking below it, very much like shadows. So, this was sort of a mathematics teacher fantasy of a universe that only exists in two dimensions. But it strikes me that actually our position isn't that much dissimilar. We're all stuck to the surface of this planet by the force G. And we can roam across this surface, but everywhere we go, our feet are always sucked firmly back down onto this two-dimensional plane. And of course, there are folds in this two-dimensional plane that we can sort of use to elevate ourselves slightly. And even if we're very careful, get right to the top of a mountain. But of course, always we will be stuck. Now you might say that, well, we can swim in water and explore three dimensions, but actually, of course, only for the length of one breath. And we can jump, but of course we'll fall back down again. Now actually, gravity doesn't work uniformly across the whole surface of the Earth. So actually, at the top of this mountain, gravity will be ever so slightly less, because G acts downwards towards the centre of the Earth. And because G diminishes with distance, if you actually get further away from the centre of the Earth, you have very slightly less gravity. So you would have thought that all points on the surface of the Earth would be the same distance, so that G works like this into the centre of this globe spinning in space. But actually that's not quite true, because actually our planet is slightly fat in the middle. So actually what that means is that gravity at the equator is slightly less and gravity at the poles is slightly more. If you weighed 100 kilograms and stood at the poles and weighed yourself, and then went to Mexico City. Mexico City is the place with the least gravity, because not only is it relatively near the equator, it's also very high. And so actually you would weigh half a kilogram less at Mexico City. So if you want to lose weight, go to Mexico City. So it seemed bizarre to me that we live our whole lives like these shadows that Edwin Abbott described, sliding across this two-dimensional surface and pretty much unaware of the three-dimensional space above us and below us. And I began to start a campaign to raise awareness of the sky. So this was one of the first proposals. It's sadly proved to be rather difficult to achieve. And so actually what the first attempt to raise awareness of the sky actually became this. So I employed various people to hold a sign attempting to realign people's focus to the sky. The first one was in Nottingham, I think this is Sheffield. Now, of course, actually, throughout the whole of man's history, people have had this sort of tragic lust to try and escape the shackles of gravity. And not only to sort of contemplate the sky, but to try and get into the sky. So this is Edward Frost of Cambridgeshire with his ornithopter. So as you can see, it's a sort of flying machine. These are wings made of feathers. It's sort of tied together with silk, and these are willow branches. I don't know what willow is in German, but anyway. As you can probably tell, it wasn't very successful. But actually, Edward Frost did go on, however, to become the president of the Royal Aeronautical Society. So this is another machine, the Victorian machine used to try to transcribe flight. So this bird had various things attached, which then worked back to this drum, where flight is being attempted to be captured as data to learn from. And this is Franz Reichert, considered perhaps the last of birdmen. And in 1912, it's probably a bit difficult to tell from this, but you can see he's got the sort of wing construction that he's made. And he's standing on a stool, which is standing on top of the table. And in 1912, he took 5 seconds to fall 190 feet on top of the Eiffel Tower and didn't survive. So my entry into the domestic aviation started with this piece. And then several years later, and it's clearly a maquette, several years later, I developed the piece Escapable number 6. So if we can have this. Thank you. this is, okay, we missed the stuff, but anyway, it's okay. So as you can see, this is a domestic chair on a journey. What we just missed was it being released out of someone's hands. We can do some sound as well. Sorry. Okay, so the setup you can't see is that above it there's a helium-filled weather balloon that's attached to a rod with the chair dangling at one end and a camera at the other. The sound that you're hearing is the GPS data that we needed to know where this contraption had gone, because once we let go of it, it was off to its own devices and ultimately lost. So it's transmitting the data back. And I'll leave this chair slowly going on its journey whilst I carry on talking about gravity and escaping. So I think I just need slightly more. Okay. Now, of course, later I realised that actually I'm not the first person to use a domestic chair to try and escape gravity. This man, Larry Walters, actually used a garden chair to which he attached 45 helium balloons. He was someone that wanted to be a pilot. He tried to join the US Air Force, but unfortunately, due to his bad eyesight, he was only allowed to be a technician. So he did let that stop him, and so his lust to be an aviator, together with his girlfriend, he contrived the system, including lots of ballast here. So the idea was that when she cut these, he would slowly drift up and lose ballast to rise quicker. Unfortunately, he got the maths a little bit wrong. So when she cut these lines, he shot up into the sky. And very quickly disappeared out of sight. Now he took two things with him. He took a CB radio so that he could communicate with his girlfriend, and a gun so that he could shoot the balloons when he needed to come down. Sort of shooting them one by one to come down gently was the idea. So this is the footage recorded from his girlfriend's CB radio. Thank you. cadets were very alarmed and confused by exactly what was happening in their airspace. Actually, he did eventually manage to land. He shot enough balloons out so that he came down again. He reached, I think he reached about 10 kilometres. And so he did survive. Unfortunately, about 10 years later, he committed suicide. So, experiment E attempts to raise awareness of the sky number two. In a lake in a park in North London, I installed this underwater runway lights. So it's a little bit like the clandestine airstrip at the end of North by Northwest, the Hitchcock film. It sort of appeared out of the darkness as if someone was flicking a set of switches, stayed for a few moments and then disappeared again, and repeated that every 2 minutes. So in a sense, calling something from the sky. And this was a shot taken from a nearby tower block. So, as well as people ascending to Earth, of course, there's a history of people falling. The Guardian, in Wednesday, the 18th of July, 2001, had a story about Mohammed Ayaz. So this here is the Sainsbury's home base in Richmond, which is a suburb of London. And on the previous day, a worker from Sainsbury's home base discovered in the park, in the car park, in a set of bushes, what she thought was a drunk man. The police arrived and very quickly established that actually it wasn't a drunk man, it was a dead body. But no one could actually work out where it had come from. And after some investigation, what they realised was actually that Mohammed Ayaz came from somewhere very far away. He had run across the tarmac of Bahrain Airport and managed to climb the undercarriage, and believing the undercarriage section to be heated and pressurised. But as the Guardian says, by about 10 minutes into the ascent, the temperature in the wheel bay would have been freezing. At 18,000 feet, minutes later, while passengers only a few feet away were being served gin and tonic and settling down to watch in-flight movies, Ayaz would have begun to hallucinate from lack of oxygen. At 30,000 feet, the temperature is minus 56 degrees. So what happens is that these jumbo jets coming into Heathrow all follow exactly the same trajectory. It's automated, and their undercarriage drops at exactly the same point. And almost certainly, Ayaz would have been dead by this point and dropped out of the compartment and landed in one of these bushes just here. And, the Guardian went on to say that this actually wasn't the first case, and because planes always open their undercarriage here, there's actually been three different cases exactly on this spot. And the article said, these people fly across the world in this way from different places, and they all end up in a car park in Richmond. If there are any more words to call, that's where they will fall. So, experiment F attempts to raise awareness of the sky number three. This is a proposal to fit a large hook in the floor of a space and to attach to it an extremely long cable. But it's not a cable made from metal, but from a single molecule carbon cable. It doesn't actually exist at the moment, but it's a hypothetical structure. It would be incredibly strong due to it being made from one molecule. and also plugged into the mains, the electricity would be an extension lead that would run up the table. Both would go through a hole in the ceiling and then up into the sky, and up and up and up and up, and then eventually in geostationary orbit there would be my Mark II Ford Escort here, acting as a sort of beacon that this planet is inhabited and civilized, and the extension cable running up would allow the lights to be on and the radio play. Okay, escape velocity. I was talking earlier about G, the force that sticks us all to the surface of the planet. But actually, escape velocity is what we need to overcome G. So the escape velocity changes for different sizes of objects. So Jupiter, you would need to achieve the speed of 59.5 kilometers per second. It doesn't matter which direction you're going in, if you actually went at that speed, you would leave the surface of Jupiter. And Earth is slightly less, 11.2, the Moon, 2.3, and a small building or a human, it's also possible to calculate this for. So for a human, what you need would be the square root of 2 times g times the mass of the person divided by the radius of the person. So that equation will allow you to work out the speed that you need to reach to actually escape it on the moon. Okay, turn to raise a glass, let's go for. This is a very simple a microphone attached to a weather balloon and a very long lead coming down to a speaker that would then listen to the sky. Okay, so yes, G affects all bodies and on the Earth. The value of G is 9.8 meters per second, which means that a body acted on by G would accelerate by 9.8 meters per second. So let's consider the body of a mouse. Now, Galileo, famously with the Leaning Tower of Pisa, he didn't actually talk about mice, but I will. So from the top of the Leaning Tower of Pisa, if you dropped a mouse, it would fall and constantly accelerate by G. And as Galileo pointed out, if you dropped an elephant, it would be acted upon by exactly the same force, and therefore both the elephant and the mouse would hit the ground at exactly the same time. Now, actually, that's a bit of a simplification, because it's not quite true. What Galileo didn't mention is that actually there's this other force, air resistance. So they would only fall equally within a vacuum, and as it's not a vacuum, as the mouse begins to fall faster and faster, the air resistance increases, and there comes a point when air resistance is the same as G. And at that point, it's called terminal velocity, and the mouse won't actually increase speed anymore. Now, because of the ratio of surface area to volume, that's different for an elephant. The elephant has much less surface area and much more stuff inside, proportionally. So, the elephant, once you drop the elephant off, it actually never reaches terminal velocity and just carries on accelerating. The evolutionary biologist J.S. Haldane pointed out that this means that gravity affects different creatures in very, very different ways. What he said was that to the mouse and any smaller animal, it presents practically no dangers. You can drop a mouse down a 1,000-yard mine shaft, and on arriving at the bottom, it gets a slight shock and walks away, provided the ground is fairly soft. A rat is killed, a man is broken, a horse splashes. Experiment H, attempt to raise awareness of the sky, number 5. So this was the intervention called Fake Moon, and last summer, over 4 nights, this moon rose, and then over 3 hours made an arc across the sky and set in the English countryside at a time when there was no moon forecast. It also wobbled slightly, so it did achieve the effect of raising awareness. Oh, that was a close up of it. Okay, and finally, the man who fell to Earth, B. In 1959, just in the build-up to the space race, there was actually an equivalent race between Russia and America to get someone as high as possible in a helium balloon. And arguably, the first man into space is rather than Yuri Gagarin, is Kittinger, Colonel Joe Kittinger. So, so Kittinger was equipped with a pressurized outfit, which was sort of the first time that this had been tried. And he was sent up in this helium balloon with a gondola beneath it. So this is 2 years before Gagarin first went into space. Got up to 30 kilometers, but beyond that, eventually the rubber of the balloon breaks and everything falls down. So this is Kittinger just about at the very top, and at this moment he jumped, and when he did so, he experienced what nobody else had actually experienced before, which is true freefall. Now what that means is that he's actually above the atmosphere. There's hardly any atmosphere at all. So unlike the mouse, which had wind resistance working against its fall, here there's nothing to stop the fall at all. And as he jumped out, he had this moment of panic that actually he wasn't falling at all. And this is Einstein's what he called his happy thought, which is that someone falling through empty space would actually not know that they were falling at all, and it's only when you can judge yourself against something else that you have the sensation of falling. So Kittinger jumped out and was falling, but thought he was just floating. And he managed to look back at the balloon and suddenly realised that the balloon was disappearing at an incredible speed, because nothing was slowing him down. So actually, he's not only falling, but he's falling constantly accelerating. And he actually broke the speed of sound as well. This is the moment that he jumps. And actually, the pressurised suit failed. And he should have aborted the attempt, but being an American hero, he didn't. And his right hand swelled up to twice its size. So this is the footage shot partly from the balloon and partly from a camera on his helmet, I think. And he had 4 minutes of free fall. Followed, luckily, he actually lost consciousness, but the chute had an automatic override, and he then spent another, I think it was 14 minutes, drifting back to the surface of the Earth. So, arguably, he's the first man in space, and the first human being to encounter true free fall. And so, also I should point out here, we're starting to see the edge of the Earth, and the sky is now black, and where space begins is sort of arguable. I mean, sort of satellites are 100 miles away from the Earth, but at this point it's minus 60, there's no oxygen left. So to sit in this chair would be your last sitting in a chair. So as you can see, Kissinger did actually survive.